I'm Bobby Lee, and this is the Bobby Lee Show. Today we have with us Eustace Mullins, a lecturer, an author, author of many books, a scholar, Washington and Lee University, and today we're going to be talking about several different subjects. But this particular subject is the most important for today's political venue. And Eustace has written a book called The World Order. Now, Mr. Mullins has been working since for the last 50 years to research important questions that need to be answered in relationship of Middle America to the political evolution. Eustace, tell us a little bit, if you would, how you got started in being an author.
Well, I had always intended to be an author, but I had intended to write novels, perhaps some poems, and I had absolutely no interest in any research or any nonfiction work. I didn't consider that as creative writing. So I met a poet, a very bohemian person named Ezra Pound, who was then incarcerated without trial on a more or less lifetime basis. And he asked me to look into the banking interest, the Federal Reserve System, at the Library of Congress there in Washington, D.C. And I did this, and I found it to be quite an interesting story, which launched me on research which continues to the present day.
Now, this book, The New World Order, how does the New World Order deal with the banking interest in America and across the world?
Well, you see, in studying the banking system in the United States, I found it was part of an international system of banking called central banks in Europe, and that the Federal Reserve System, which we had here, was simply an American version of the central banks they had in Europe. And I also found that these banks did not exist as some entity in some world of their own. They were an integral part of what I came to call the world order.
Now, Eustace, this new world order and this banking system, I was under the impression that the banks themselves were American banks and it was the federal government that owned the banks. Are you telling me that our government itself doesn't own these banks?
Well, our government doesn't own anything. We really don't have a government. We're just a colony of England.
Hmm. How can you say that, a colony of England? Why, I know that they have the Republican Party and the Democrat parties, and I go down to the local bank, and I can cash a dollar bill, can't I?
Oh, well, you can go into any colony of Great Britain and cash a check. That doesn't mean you're in an independent nation.
Would you trace for me the colony of Great Britain to the United States and the banks? If I put a Federal Reserve note in the bank today, how can I say or how can you tell me that's a part of a colony of Great Britain?
Well, you see, we started out as a colony of Great Britain, and then presumably we won political independence in the American Revolution. But you see, the American Revolution was not against the bank. The American Revolution was against King George III. So we won against King George III, but we didn't win against the Bank of England, of which King George III was a major stockholder. So King George lost this wonderful colony over here, but he retained the banking control and continued to get his interest and his profits from his American colony, just as before.
Okay, let's go from King George to the Federal Reserve. What happened in between? Because there was some time in there, and some people say that Andrew Jackson was one of the best presidents this country ever had. Could you tell us about him, and what did he do in regard to banking?
Well, you see, immediately after the Revolution, when we had our wonderful independence, and we could have the 4th of July and shoot off firecrackers and still pay interest to the Bank of England, which no one seemed to mind, because they didn't know about it, and so Andrew Hamilton reestablished the Bank of England presence in the United States of America immediately after the Revolution, called the First Bank of the United States, which Jefferson strongly opposed. And when Jefferson became president, he refused to renew the charter of this foreign central bank, the first bank of the United States, so it went out of existence. And in revenge for that, England declared war on us, and we had the War of 1812, which was simply a banking war. Of course, you won't read that in any history book in England or in the United States. They tell you that American seamen were being impressed by the British Navy. They would stop American ships and impress American seamen. And this was the occasion of the war. Well, it had nothing to do with it. It was simply the Bank of England said, we're going to punish the United States for refusing to renew the charter of the First Bank of the United States. So anyway, the First Bank of the United States disappeared, and then Nicholas Biddle, an agent of James Rothschild of Paris, chartered a second bank of the United States. And it was doing quite well until Andrew Jackson came along, and he said to the bankers, you are a nest of vipers, and by God, I will rout you out. And so he did. He removed all of the government deposits from the Second Bank of the United States in 1836, which caused it to collapse. And in revenge, the Bank of England suspended all American paper, which caused the first great depression in the United States, called the Panic of 1837. That was strictly a banker's panic. And of course, then the Rothschilds came in and bought up American securities at 1 cent on the dollar and established a great many of the great American fortunes, including J.P. Morgan.
But Andrew Jackson himself, you would credit him with at least taking a stand against this banking monopoly that is destroying his America.
Well, he was a general and a patriot and an American, and to him, the bankers were Satan incarnate. They were robbing and looting this country. They were oppressing the people. They were causing financial depression and widespread suffering. And he said, I'm going to go after them. And he did. Unfortunately, the history books do not tell you why he did anything that he did. So the American children go to school and they have no idea what all this was about. Neither do the college students. Neither do the graduate college students.
You know, I saw a beautiful statue of Andrew Jackson not long ago up in Jacksonville, Florida. And a lot of people don't realize that the state of Florida, the first governor was Andrew Jackson.
Yes, that's right.
And this city of Jacksonville was named after this wonderful patriot and hero of the American middle class. Now, let's go a little bit further. You mentioned the word Rothschilds. Where did that name come from, please?
Well, there was a family of moneylenders in Frankfurt, Germany named Bauer, which means peasant. And why these moneylenders were trying to call themselves peasants, I don't know, because none of them had ever been near a plow in their life. And so they were moneylenders, and they needed some way of advertising their business. And so the founder of this dynasty, the House of Rothschild, put up a red shield above his door so that people who came from various parts of Europe to change money with him could find it. And so after a few years, people didn't know who Bauer was, but they knew the Rothschild. The Red Shield was Rothschild, and so he simply began to call himself Rothschild.
Okay, now he died eventually, but did he leave a dynasty of some sort? I mean, how did this happen?
Well, he left five sons who were very well trained by this man, who by that time had become the outstanding money lender of Europe. Due to a very peculiar circumstance, King George III and the Bank of England wanted to punish the American colonists for being so obstreperous and for refusing to give all of their profits to the Bank of England from their income. And so when they rebelled, then the British army did not really want to fight their American cousins. So King George said, well, I've got to get somebody else to fight this war. I need some mercenaries, some hired soldiers. And over in Germany, the Elector of Hesse, a German province, had a very well-trained group of soldiers called the Hessians. And so he said, well, I'll rent these out to you, King George, who was a German himself, by the way, a Hanover. And he said, for $5 million, you can have this nice army. And so George said, all right. And then when the Elector of Hesse got this $5 million, he said, what am I going to do with it? And they said, well, this... there's a very good investor and financial advisor named Meyer Amschel Rothschild there in Frankfurt. So he let Meyer Amschel lend out this money, which was the biggest chunk of capital in Europe at that time, $5 million. And so Amschel spread it around, and pretty soon he brought back $20 million to the elector, who was very pleased, and kept $5 million for his efforts. So now he was a monetary power himself, and of course the elector of Hesse let it be known that if you had money to invest, put it in Meyer Amschel's hands. So when Meyer died, he had five sons, and so they dispersed themselves over the five capitals of Europe, and Nathan went to London, James went to Paris, and so forth. So they now had total control of the monetary resources of Western civilization, the entire continent of Europe. And they had developed some very interesting techniques. One was that the courier went from James in Paris to Nathan, mayor in London, and he wanted $1 million in gold. So he would give him a note saying, I want $1 million in gold, but he would not sign it. So if someone came into a Rothschild office, a courier, and said, I have a request here for $1 million, it's signed James Rothschild, and Nathan knew it was fake because they didn't sign their communications.
A little trickery even then, but I think good little trickery.
Well, you live and learn, you know.
That's right. So we're talking about the New World Order. In the New World Order, we had the war with England, and that was the Revolutionary War. And there was the banking system that was set up, and that was Alexander Hamilton that set it up originally after that. Thomas Jefferson then went ahead and decided this was not good for the American people. And then after that, we had the War of 1812, and then we come to Andrew Jackson, and he fought the bankers again, and then we have the Rothschilds, and their dynasty is building. Tell us about the Rothschilds now, how they enter into the picture as far as, shall we say, the Federal Reserve is concerned.
Well, the Rothschilds realized early on you don't make any money by lending somebody $200 to buy a used car. They only dealt with governments and with the kings of Europe, and they only handled government loans because that's where the big money was. And you see, they realized it was a sure thing because if you lent money to a government and they didn't repay you, then they would never get any more money. And they always needed money for wars and for to build Versailles and so forth. To be a king means you spend a lot of money. You're a big spender. And they could always tax their people enough to repay the Rothschilds their money, so they had nothing to worry about. And so by 1880, the Rothschilds really owned all of Europe, and they owned a large part of the United States secretly, because they always advertised and promoted the idea that the Rothschilds had no activities in the United States, and they did not, because they worked through August Belmont, who was their named representative, and they also worked through J.P. Morgan and Kuhn Loeb Company, which were their secret representatives. And by 1896, these two Rothschild firms, J.P. Morgan and Kuhn Loeb, owned 96% of all the railroad mileage in the United States.
Wow, talk about a monopoly there.
And that's in congressional reports. I got that right out of, most of my work, by the way, comes from congressional reports.
So you do researching on congressional reports, and how far do you back to this research information go, Eustace?
About 5,000 years.
5,000 years. We're talking to Eustace Mullins, ladies and gentlemen, and we're talking about the New World Order. Well, tell us then, the Rothschilds, tell us about the Federal Reserve. Now they've become involved in the Federal Reserve, and what about Soviet Russia? How did Soviet Russia come into this New World Order situation, Mr. Mullins?
Well, Soviet Russia was always part of the World Order, and in fact, the Soviet Empire, the evil empire, which we heard so much about, and in the 1950s, we were digging atom bomb shelters in our backyards to protect us from this catastrophe, which was going to happen at any moment, and which was good for the contracting industry, but it didn't really help anybody as far as avoiding atomic bombs. So the Soviet Empire came about because of greed and envy. Now, communism, of course, is based on hatred, greed, and envy, but what people don't realize is that the Russian Revolution came about because of the greed and envy of King George V of England for his cousin, Tsar Nicholas II of Russia, who happened to be the richest man in the world. And when you're the richest man in the world, the consequence is all the people who are not quite as rich hate you and wish they could get their hands on your money. So the Rothschilds told King George V, they were all around him as his advisors in London. They said, look, let's go after Nick and get his dough. And George said, well, I'm game. And so the Rothschilds started the communist movement in Russia. And so they murdered the Tsar and his family and took his gold, which was sent to Paris and to Kuhn Loeb Company in New York and the other Rothschild offices, London and so forth. And some of this money, by the way, these Rothschild banks used to buy the original stock of the Federal Reserve System in 1914. That was all bought with the Tsar's money. And so the Romanov heirs, such as are still alive, are the real owners of our Federal Reserve System. And so, as I say, they murdered the richest man in the world, took all of his money.
Well, what year was that, by the way? What year was that when they murdered the Tsar?
Well, that was 1918. They had the communist revolution in 1917. And the first thing they did was go in and loot the whole country. They took all the money. And the result was the new Soviet empire had no operating capital, and they couldn't tax anybody because they had murdered all the people who owned anything. So you couldn't go out and tax the peasants to keep the country running. So they sent up cries of anguish, and people all over the world responded. Woodrow Wilson, our president, he made a speech to Congress in which he said, it is our duty to help these noble murderers in Moscow, in so many words. And so he first sent them $25 million of his personal war fund, voted to him by Congress to prosecute World War I. And he sent Elihu Root, who, by the way, wrote the charters of all the major foundations. Elihu Root was a lawyer of whom J.P. Morgan said, when I call in lawyers and I want something done, they give me a lot of reasons why it cannot be done. He said, when I call in Elihu Root, Elihu Root says, what do you want me to do? And I tell him, and he does it. So that's why he became the lawyer for the big bankers in this country.
Now, tell me, Eustace, because there's a lot of people that have said that the banking themselves, that the communist revolution was started on Wall Street. Is that a true fact or not, Eustace Mullins?
It's absolutely true. All of the money for Wall Street, for the Bolshevik Revolution, came from Wall Street, really from Rothschild firms, but it would have been too obvious if the Rothschilds of London were sending all their money over to Russia to help the communists. So they did it through their favorite patsy, which is the American government. And they even formed a special firm on Wall Street in 1916 to finance the communist revolution in Russia, which was called American International Corporation. And its directors were Percy Rockefeller, the richest men in the United States, including a financier named George Herbert Walker, who just happened to be the grandfather of George Bush, our president.
Now, how does this George Bush fit in now? George Herbert Walker Bush, the former president, or about to be president of the United States, formerly anyway, how does he fit in with his father, and was it his father and the Rockefellers and the Harrimans and the Brown brothers? Did they all work together as far as this New World Order is concerned?
Well, the New World Order is a group of insiders. It's sort of an international mafia. And they either work together or they get eliminated. I mean, these people have to cooperate because the death sentence is automatic if you don't. And you don't say, I'm going my way, to heck with you, because if you go your way is straight down. Mm-hmm. And George Bush was like a lot of scions of these World Order families. That is, he was unemployable. I mean, if he came in to be interviewed and there were eight people there, he would be the eighth one that you would hire if you had to hire eight people. And, you know, Lyndon Johnson...
He should have had seven others when he was running for president of the United States.
Well, it's too bad it didn't. Lyndon Johnson was quite a perceptive guy. He was a Texas redneck, and he came to Washington and he looked at all these bright young men at the Central Intelligence Agency who were from the wealthiest families in the United States. They were there as a lark. They wanted to play James Bond, and their families would do... and as Lyndon said, he said, the CIA is composed of scions of wealthy families whose families would never dare let them near the business because it would be dissolved within 6 weeks. So George Herbert Bush, George Herbert Walker Bush, when a you know, he finished at Yale, and he said, well, should we put him in the family firm of Brown Brothers Harriman? They said, good God, no, we'll be in the breadlines within 2 months. So they said, let him go work, let him do what everybody else does, go work for the Central Intelligence Agency and travel around and have fun. So George went to work for the CIA. It's the only job he ever had, just like Bill Buckley, another scion of a wealthy family. Bill Buckley was hired by the CIA when he finished at Yale, Skull and Bones. We're talking about the Brotherhood of Death here, the Skull and Bones crowd, which Bill Buckley and George Bush and all of the partners at Brown Brothers Harriman were members of this Illuminati fraternity established in 1848 as the Russell Trust by Daniel Coit Gilman, who also, by the way, later set up the charitable foundations. Gilman was on the board of all of these so-called charitable foundations, which were simply secret instruments of the world order.
So George became a member of the CIA. Matter of fact, he was CIA director in 1976. An interesting thing happened to Eustace in 76, and that was when he met one Saddam Hussein, who became involved in power in Iraq at the time. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, George was always a business partner of Saddam, and he claimed he didn't know him, so he deliberately, when he was on camera, he always mispronounced his name. He always called him Sodom, as though he were trying to call him a sodomite, I don't know. But anyway, they've been business partners that goes way back. And Sodom himself, you know, is worth about $10 billion. He's a player on the world scene. And that's why when George was ranting about getting rid of the new Hitler, and he sent our army over there to do it, they walked away, leaving Saddam Hussein in total control. I don't think he ever heard a gunshot fired during that entire Iraqi war. But to get back to George, he didn't start out with the CIA. He started out as an agent, a secret agent of the CIA, who was running his own oil company called Zapata Oil Company. And, you know, George, when he wanted a name for his company, he wanted a name that really represented what he believed in. So he didn't call it the Thomas Jefferson Oil Company, and he didn't call it the George Washington Oil Company. He looked down at Mexico, where you had a communist revolutionary named General Emiliano Zapata. And Emiliano was quite a bloodthirsty guy. His idea of a good time was to go into a village and line up all the women and children and shoot them. So George said, this is my kind of guy. So he named his oil company Zapata Oil Company, which showed the kind of people that he would like to have around him. And the Zapata Oil Company was never anything but a front for the CIA. They did a lot of work in Mexico and in the Gulf of Mexico for the CIA. And of course, when you had the supposed attack against Castro to wipe out communism in Cuba, George was in on the planning. And of course, they bought two ships to haul freedom fighters to Cuba, and they named one of them Barbara after his wife, and they named the other ship Zapata after his oil company. So George was pretty well inside all the way. And of course, they never intended to overthrow Castro. You see, when you set up a regime that you control, like in 1917 they set up the Bolshevik regime, and the American taxpayer supported the Soviet empire from 1917 right up till the time it collapsed. And the only reason it collapsed was that the United States was bankrupt and it couldn't send them any more money. So we destroyed communism by going bankrupt ourselves, which I guess is one way of doing it.
You said one time, Eustace, that the Russians have been trying to make it through the winter every winter since the inception of the communism, and we've been helping them through the winter.
Well, the guy who helped them first was Herbert Hoover. After they sent him money, Wilson sent him money, and then they said, we don't have any food. So Herbert Hoover, the great engineer, who was a Rothschild employee, after he had been banned for life from the London Stock Exchange as a thief and an embezzler, and the Rothschilds said, boy, we want this guy on our side.
Sure.
So they hired him as a director of Rio Tinto Zinc, one of their family firms. And so then in 1916, the Germans said, look, we can't fight any longer. We don't have any more money, we don't have any more food, and we don't have any more coal. So the Rothschilds said, well, hang on, and we'll see what we can do. So they got Herbert Hoover to inaugurate the German Relief Commission. But since we were at war with Germany, they couldn't well call it the German Relief Commission, so they called it the Belgian Relief Commission. And the Belgians were suddenly were astounded to find out that they were all starving when they had just had the best crop year they ever had. But anyway, the Belgian Relief Commission, which, by the way, was one of the greatest thieveries in the world, Herbert Hoover and his pals who ran this operation, they all came out of it multimillionaires. And Herbert Hoover, several times, remarked very sourly, some of these days, some prying SOB is going to want to look at our books. Well, no one ever did, and they kept their money. But after the Belgian Relief Commission, which kept the Germany in the World War One for two more years and brought a very satisfactory conclusion, then they called on Herbert to help them out again. They said, look, the Bolsheviks are starving. They've shot all the peasants and the farmers, and they have no food. So Herbert Hoover then organized Russian relief, and he went over and saved the Bolsheviks from total collapse. And somehow, after this, he became known as a great anti-communist, which just shows you what, when you control the media, you can sell any story that you want.
Absolutely. And one of the things that was so sad for me to read about, of course, was when the Bolsheviks did go into the Ukraine, and they did kill so many people, they starved between 6 and 8 million Ukrainians out. And this is the end result of what America has done, because America itself, this government, not the country, I don't believe the country, Eustace, I don't believe the patriotic people in the country, but this government was responsible for funding situations like this, weren't they?
Oh, very much so. And in fact, this great massacre of the Russian peasants in the early 1930s was deliberately suppressed by Walter Duranty, the chief correspondent in Russia of the New York Times, and he dictated what would be allowed to be sent back to this country. They totally suppressed this so that Franklin D. Roosevelt, as a principal plank of his platform in 1933, that was to give official diplomatic recognition to Soviet Russia so we could send them even more money, of taxpayers' money, than they'd been doing before. So, but they couldn't do this if the press was going to print a story that 10 to 12 million Russians had been murdered by Stalin. So the story was completely suppressed, and in fact, the American people today really don't know whether to believe it or not. There have been several books out about it by Robert Conquest, which are very good, totally documented, but they don't get much play in the media.
Mm-hmm. You know, they had a movie at one time on PBS, but PBS refused to run it in most of its affiliate, and that was Harvest of Despair.
Oh, yes.
It was a television, I think it was about an hour and a half long, or a couple hours anyway, but it showed exactly what happened and the terrible human tragedy that this government, the United States of America government, was involved in by the fact that they supported communism in other parts of the world, namely the Soviet Union at that time. You know, it's interesting to me, Eustace, that over 70 million people have been killed by communism, many by their own people, and we still support governments like that. How can this happen, Eustace Mullins?
Well, you mentioned public broadcasting system, PBS, which to most people in the know, they call it the phony. They say PBS stands for the phony broadcasting system because they're a bunch of goofy left-wingers and homosexuals, and they're so relentlessly far left in their orientation that occasionally some congressman or some senator will point out, has PBS ever published any or run anything which was of a conservative nature? And of course the answer is no. And whenever someone in Washington points this out, why they would have to point it out, I don't know, because all you got to do is turn this phony broadcasting system on and you can see it for yourself. But whenever a congressman mentions this, they immediately denounce him in the entire press as a hate monger, guy who wants to suppress freedom of speech. Mm-hmm. And, of course, there is no freedom of speech on the phony broadcasting system because it's totally left-wing.
Now, we have a number of people, different types of people, different nationalities in this world. We had World War One, we had World War Two, we had South Korean War, and then we had Vietnam. Should we have fought any of those wars, Eustace Mullins? Was there a real reason? And what was the end result of us being involved in, say, World War One and World War Two?
Well, John, you have to understand what wars are. Wars are carefully staged productions. Now, these are all carefully staged, and they did what they were supposed to do, and they had a good audience, and so I think they were successful. But to say that these wars were about anything, that they had some particular philosophy of government opposing another philosophy of government, is total nonsense. These were world order productions, and as I say, they were carefully staged. Both sides were set up to perform in a certain manner, and the outcome was always predetermined. In other words, you were looking at a staged production, which you had already seen many times, a sort of a soap opera, and you knew how it was going to come out before it even started.
Now, Eustace, you're a veteran, and I'm a veteran. And I know when I went in the service, I was just about as patriotic as anybody could possibly be. That's the way that I felt, anyway. And, you know, I saw things in the service, Eustace Mullins, that would lead me to believe that I still love my country, don't get me wrong, but it's this government that I don't think that I'd ever fight for again, because you just kill a lot of people, raise a lot of debt, raise a lot of taxes. I come back, the people are far worse off than they ever were before, and we seem to be enslaving ourselves. Is this true, or am I imagining things?
Oh, you're not imagining anything. In fact, I was in the Air Force during World War II, and I can't say that we were very patriotic, because during our basic training down here at Miami Beach, we were marching along, drilling in the morning, and we were singing to cadence, and we would sing, "I hate wall. Eleanor hates wall. My dog, Voila, hates wall." And all we did was make fun of these phonies in Washington, you see. So I can't say that we were that patriotic. And over in England, whenever Winston Churchill came on, Evelyn Waugh, one of the most famous English novelists, pointed out in his memoirs that whenever Winston Churchill came on the radio while they were sitting around in their officers' club, with one of his great speeches, they would sit around, they would laugh themselves to tears at this old drunk, you see. So when you say patriotism, I don't know how much patriotism there really was.
Tell us a little bit more about Winston Churchill. Was he a bought and paid for?
Yes, Winston Churchill at times spoke out against communism. You know, he was the son of a syphilitic named Randolph Churchill, but whether apparently he didn't inherit the taint, but anyway, he was always a little goofy, and he was really a drunk. If he didn't have his two quarts of whiskey a day, he really didn't know where he was. And during the great Blitz of London, most people thought he was, you know, being very brave, staying in London during the Blitz Krieg.
And oh, that's where his two quarts of whiskey were.
Well, he was 8 stories down. They built him a special shelter, 8 stories down in the ground, a very comfortable room, and he was liberally supplied with whiskey. And in fact, they used to show this room to tourists after the war, but a historian named David Irving did a new biography of Winston Churchill, and he was an establishment historian. He was published by Macmillan, which is owned by the Rothschilds. And so he sent this new biography of Churchill to the offices of Macmillan, in which he went in at some length about how this old drunk slept out the war in this special room underneath London. And they said, "Oh, no, you can't print that." And he said, "Well, that's the key to my whole biography." And so they said, "Well, goodbye," and they refused to print the book. And he finally got it out on his own, and he started touring and lecturing on some of his discoveries, with the result that Canada officially banned him from entering Canada as a very dangerous person, because he was telling the truth about Winston Churchill. And they have riots when he speaks, you know, and it's all very exciting.
We're talking with Eustace Mullins today, ladies and gentlemen, and this is the book. It's The World Order by, and it's about our secret rulers. It's extremely, extremely important that we understand what is happening in America today, because we do have a $4 trillion debt. The nation is on its way down. We've become a third world entity. And we used to be the finest, the most, the strongest, the most industrialized, the number one nation in the world. And our education system also used to be the very best. We're having severe problems, ladies and gentlemen, and that's why Bobby Lee is here today with Eustace Mullins, one of the patriarchs and the heroes of the truth and the Jeffersonian philosophy of government. So this is the book that I think that you must, must have in your possession in order to become educated about the world order. The business of America, what really, when we're talking about the business of America, what is the business of America? I thought it was for little businesses to be able to start and to work hard and to progress, and for a small family to be able to build themselves up and become financially successful and with morals and ethics, and everybody work for the common good. Is that the way that business is done in the government today?
No, that's the myth. But we, unfortunately, you and I are talking here today about the reality. We could talk about myths all evening if we wished, but if we're going to talk about reality, then we have to say that this is a soap opera from Hollywood, the American dream. What we are facing today is the American nightmare, a wholly owned colony dictated to by aliens, in which the chance of a young person today of making it is almost nil, unless he happens to be a scion of one of the insider world order dynastic families, as George Bush was. Now, George Bush, of course, his path was smooth. He was a member of the Brotherhood of Death from Yale University. And we were so lucky to have him replaced by Bill Clinton, apparently from Middle America, the heartland of America, a Rockefeller protege, a Rhodes Scholar. There's never been a Rhodes Scholar. They're the Rothschild Scholars, but they didn't want to call themselves Rothschild Scholars, so they named themselves Rhodes Scholars. So we have now in Washington Bill Clinton, a Rothschild Scholar and Rockefeller protege. You know, the Washington Post on June 21st explained the sudden meteoric rise of Bill Clinton when you had all these people contending for the presidential nomination in the Democratic Party, and they all looked equally qualified, they all looked equally stupid, and which would satisfy the American
people.
And they were all lawyers, and they were all protégés and insiders. You had Albert Gore, whose family has lived off of largesse from Arm & Hammer for many years, the founder of the Communist Party of the United States, and this has all been printed in the Washington Post and many other places. So suddenly the Rockefellers said, well, it's time for the show to be over, and so Senator Jay Rockefeller and David Rockefeller notified them, Clinton is the man, I want all you other people to disappear, and so Clinton came forth as number one Rockefeller choice.
You know, it's amazing. Of course, you know, to me, from changing from George Herbert Walker Bush to Bill Clinton is just like leaving the soiled diaper on the baby and just changing the safety pin.
Well, very good analysis.
Right. But it was money bought and paid for, as you know, and Jackson Stevens loaned Bill Clinton $2 million, and that was back in, I believe, around February or so, and Bill Clinton was really kind of almost getting down towards the bottom of the heap of those seven individuals that at first had decided to run for President of the United States on the Democratic ticket, and all of a sudden he had this money. He came into Georgia, had 26 people that he employed as far as being front people, and pretty soon he took Georgia in the South, and he was well on his way, and I think that was pretty close to it. But he was a bought and paid for, you're saying. You're saying that Bill Clinton himself is bought and paid for, and are you telling me that we voted for a change, and the change isn't going to come to our benefit, Eustace?
Well, that reminds me of a story I heard in my small town in Virginia, and these two businessmen were talking, and one of them had a bill that he wanted to be approved in Congress, and he said, I wonder if I couldn't influence Congressman so-and-so in Washington to vote for this bill if I, you know, just bought him. And the other man said, don't be ridiculous. That's the most insulting thing I ever heard of. He said, Congressman so-and-so was bought and paid for long before he ever got to Washington.
And that's an honest congressman. Once he's bought and paid for, you know, he stays bought and paid for,
absolutely.
I guess.
Absolutely. He goes off the block. He's right. No longer available.
Right. We're coming to today, and we're coming from George Bush to Bill Clinton. What do you see in the future for America for the next 10 years, Eustace Mullins? This new world order, is it taking shape, or do you think that all of a sudden we're going to come to critical mass and it's all going to disintegrate before our very eyes?
Well, I think we're at critical mass already. Now, we have a very interesting situation, which we saw during the last election. You had the biggest turnout that you ever had, and of course, the trend had been for lower and lower percentages of the American people to come out and vote, because they did everything that they possibly could to discouraged the American people from participating in the election. Fewer people voted every year because, you know, they made sure, they understood, you either vote for Tweedledum or Tweedledee, and it doesn't make any difference which one gets in, because we created them both out of nothing, just like the Federal Reserve creates money out of nothing, and we create these politicians out of nothing. And when you look at them, you can see that they come from nothing.
They are nothing.
There's no question.
Absolutely nothing.
there's no question about that in anyone's mind. Well, this time, you suddenly had a wild card, and that was a billionaire named Perot. He appeared on the scene, and he was almost elected president by acclamation. People were so disgusted with these phonies, Bush and Clinton, and no matter how hard you tried, you couldn't say anything good about either one of them. And so the people looked, and here's a successful businessman, Perot, spunky, got down to business. He would get on television and rivet the attention of the American audience simply with a few charts, which has always been a no-no in politics. You never show a chart to the people if you want to get votes.
Well, you never tell them how it's really like.
Well, that's right. And you never tell them, look, we're destitute, we got to start thinking of something. Because, you see, the Rothschilds and the World Order dynastic families, they profit by other people's suffering and despair. They profit when you have a communist revolution go in and murder 10 million peasants. They profit when you have a world war which devastates Europe. And so, this is exactly what happens. You know, Baron Alphonse de Rothschild was asked during the communist revolution there, he said, aren't you worried about all of your houses and your vast estates and so forth with the revolution going on? He said, certainly not. He said, you always want to buy when blood is running in the streets. That is, when everybody thinks we're collapsing, nothing's going to be worth anything, and they say, I'm going to dump this for a penny on the dollar. That's when the Rothschilds and the insiders buy everything. And of course, the United States is coming to that point now. We're in a recession. Real estate is down. This is the time to buy, because this is a fluctuating thing. It goes up and it comes down. It goes up and it comes down, because it's manipulated. It's always manipulated. You know, J.P. Morgan was asked once, as the leading banker in the United States, someone rushed up to him and said, Mr. Morgan, please, would you tell me, what is the stock market going to do? He said, sir, it will fluctuate.
I love it. That's a great story. Let's go back to the dynasties, because one time I heard you speaking, Eustace, and you said that there are three tiers as far as the dynasty of families is concerned, from the Rothschilds and the New World Order. Could you explain that three-tier system to me?
Well, nothing can really function unless there's a hierarchy. Somebody at the top has to tell the people lower down what to do and how to think and how to act and so forth. So in the World Order, you have a very distinct hierarchy. Dynastic families who can trace their lineage back thousands of years, and because they have learned to survive and how to manipulate other people to do their will. And that's all being a member of the World Order means. You know how to use other people and profit by them. And whether you slaughter them or rob them or torture them, whatever you do, you make money at it. And this is what they do. So in the World Order, you have a top hierarchy of first-tier rank of dynastic families composed, really, of the old surviving aristocracies of Europe, the black nobility, they're called. They're called the black nobility because they came from the darker strain in the aristocracy of Europe. And the old Viking, blue-eyed, blonde aristocrats, more or less, were pushed into the background, or they intermarried with the black nobility and became contaminated. And this is what you have. Of course, the surviving royal family in Europe today is the royal family of England, and they have been black nobility since the 12th century, when the Este family of Italy married into the British royal family. So the first rank, first tier, is the old aristocracies of Europe, plus what they call their Hofjuden, their court Jews, which are the Rothschilds and families of that nature, who are able to raise money for them and keep them functioning. Now, in the second tier of world dynastic families, the world order, you have the families who themselves are enormously rich and powerful, but their duty is to serve as courtiers to the first tier of dynastic families. And people in that category are the Rockefellers, the Harrimans, the Morgans, and so forth. Now you have a third tier of dynastic families who serve the second tier. They're never allowed to approach the real top people in the first tier, but they can only serve through the serving the second tier. And these are families like George Herbert Walker Bush family. George Herbert Walker was president of W.A. Harriman Company, and the Bush family's entire career in banking was to serve the Harriman interests, who in turn served the Rothschilds. So that's why I began to use the term about Bush as a dynastic family in the world order of the third tier. And it was picked up, and I see it popping up everywhere. They say, George Bush is a third tier family. They don't even know what they're talking about. They don't explain it because they don't know how to explain it, but that's at least it. Much of my material, by the way, Bob, I see popping up all over the place because it goes into the system and is sort of piped in and begins to be picked up by people. For instance, columnists like Pat Buchanan and James Kilpatrick, every once in a while they'll pick up something of mine. Pat Buchanan had a column not long ago in which he denounced the Trotskyite wing, the neoconservatives of the Republican Party, which I had been speaking about publicly for about 5 years, and which I describe in my book, The Rape of Justice. I give you the whole story about that takeover. And as I say, it's rather flattering to see these things come out in public piecemeal. Mm-hmm. They never really explain it, and of course they never attribute it to my writings, but at least it's getting around, and that's helpful.
Now, we've had this last election, of course. H. Ross Perot did an excellent job. Wonderful job. He only collected 20%, though, because of the fact, I think a lot of people in the media themselves always kept saying, well, a third party can't win. And yet we've had a two-party system in this country, but some people say it's just one party. It's the Democrat wing of the Communist Party or the Republican wing of the Communist Party. Could you explain that? Could that be true at all?
Well, it's been true since 1933. You see, you had a man in a wheelchair running for governor of New York named Franklin D. Roosevelt, Delano Roosevelt, and he was the grandson of the most successful opium dealer in Hong Kong named Warren Delano. And, you know, the myth about the great fortunes of this country is that these were hardworking people who saved their money and built important businesses. The fact is, most of the old family money in this country came from dealing in drugs and dealing in slaves, the slave trade and the world opium trade. Mm-hmm. And of course the Roosevelt, the Delano Roosevelts.
Well, we've become the slaves now. They're still dealing in slaves.
Well, what has happened in this country and over the world is we have reverted through the world order, we've reverted to the Middle Ages. We have a feudal system now in which you might say futile system because of the way it works, but it's a feudal system in which you have the serfs and you have the lords in the castle, and that's it. And there's not to be anything in between. You see, the great achievement of Western culture, of European culture, was to produce, to move from the Middle Ages into modern times by producing a middle class, a hard-working, thrifty, sober group of people who created businesses and went into production, and they built homes and businesses and so forth, and they brought prosperity. But you see, when you're very rich, you don't like to see prosperity. I mean, what's the good of having money when everybody else has money, you see? So the world order, they want to see everybody poor.
Then they can control them, is that it?
They can control them, and also it's much more satisfying to have a castle and a yacht if you know that all the peasants down there will never have these things and compete with you, you see.
Right.
So the world order is a monopoly system, and they make their money out of monopolies, and with their monopoly they control the governments, they control the banks, and they set their prices, and it's an extortion system, really, just like the Internal Revenue Service in this country. I traced it right back to the Middle Ages, the black hand of the mafia. And all of their techniques and all of their goals come right out of the black hand.
Well, I'd like to give that IRS a backhand for their black-handedness, to tell you the truth. How do we turn this around? If they allegedly have the power, And money is power, Eustace. And a lot of people say, they've got all the money, you know, they have control of the government, they have control of the Republican Party, Democrat parties, they have the bureaucracy. Well, how do you fight a little bit of strength like that?
Well, I have to disagree with you there, Bobby Lee. Money is not power. Knowledge is power.
Okay.
And unfortunately for the world order people, information is catching up with them. You have channels of mass communication. In fact, if we were to get on national television with 30 minutes of what we're talking about today, you would have a revolution in this country. They can only survive by desperate defensive measures, by keeping us from reaching the American people with the truth. And of course, we're fighting despite of. And that's been what my 50-year career has been, to bring the knowledge that I have and that Ezra Pound imparted to me almost 50 years ago to the American people. And of course, the reason you had this great turnout in this particular election that just passed was the American people knew something was wrong and some of this material was leaking out. You know, I've circulated over 1 million books and over 1,000 articles in the past 50 years. And the information is getting there. Even though, to the national media, I still do not exist. I'm a non-person.
And that's one of the things that they try to do, Eustace, isn't it? I mean, it's they either smear people or they don't allow them to be able to present their knowledge. There's so many different ways, techniques that they have that are certainly un-American.
Well, the publishing industry in this country is totally owned. In fact, one of the biggest influences in the publishing industry in this country is the Central Intelligence Agency. They commission and have written and publish and circulate around 200 books of political propaganda a year, which makes the CIA the biggest publisher in the United States, secretly. And of course, there is no Central Intelligence Agency. It's a branch of the British Secret Intelligence Service, SIS, which was established in 1694 as a necessary adjunct of the Bank of England. So we have never had a government intelligence service. What we have is a branch of the Bank of England, which, as I say, has commissioned and published these 200 books a year of political propaganda, which are distributed to all the universities, and every professor in our universities knows that you have got to use these political propaganda books of the CIA as your teaching textbooks.
You have Zygmunt Brzezinski. He used to be one of the right-hand men of Jimmy Carter. Henry Kissinger, with Richard Nixon. These people hardly speak English to some degree, but yet they're controlling, in many cases, the foreign policy of this country. Tell them, you know, foreign policy of this country, I mean, it's really been foreign as far as I'm concerned. Could you explain why?
Well, you're talking now about the field of lecturing and public speaking, which is one of my fields. And interestingly enough, the fees paid to public speakers in the United States are proportioned inversely to how much information they give to the American people. Now, speakers who get between $35,000 and $100,000 per speech get up and give speeches in which they say absolutely nothing. And then when you have people on my level who give you solid information by the ton, we get practically no fees whatsoever because they don't even want us to ever appear in public.
We ask you to support the Bobby Lee and the Eustace Mullins Fund, and we will be bringing you in the future other videos, and we want you to go ahead and purchase as many of Eustace's books as possible. There is a number that you can call right now. It'll be on your screen, and you call and you order some of those books, and this is for the posterity of your children, your family, your future. You need to know. Thanks for being with us today on the Bobby Lee Show. And Eustace Mullins, thank you, sir, for being a part of America and the great patriot that you are.
Red, white, and blue. We must take America. back.